Welcome to my talk, Augmented Reality Training for Industrial Assembly Work. My name is Sebastian Büttner. In this talk, I'd like to address the question, are projection-based augmented reality assistive system an appropriate tool for assembly training? This work was carried out by me and my colleagues Michael Briller and Carsten Röcker. When we look into industrial production, obviously a lot of things have changed over the last decades. Besides automation, we observed that complex products are still assembled in a manual way. In the past, various projection-based AR systems have been presented to support workers. These systems use projectors to show work instructions in the work area. Some authors also use the terms in situ projections or projection mapping. Previous work has been motivated by different scenarios. The first scenario refers to the use of such systems for flexible production. The second scenario is the use of such systems to support people with disabilities. We call these first two scenarios permanent use scenario, since the assistive system is used permanently during work. With our work, we aim to look into a third scenario, the training scenario. We'd like to know whether such systems can be used for on-the-job training for new employees. Consequently, with our work, we focus on the efficiency of building up procedural knowledge and on knowledge sustainability. So, the goal of our work is to learn about the training efficiency and the knowledge sustainability of AR assistive systems. For this purpose, we run an experiment. We compared AR training with two control groups. The first control group is a personal training in which a trainer shows the assembly process to the trainee. We consider this control group as an optimal case scenario. The second control group is self-learning with technical documentation only. We consider the second control group as a low-cost case, since no personnel is required. Of course, this is not the first work dealing with AR support for procedural tasks. At CHI 2003, Tang et al. Presented work on AR support for object assembly. They compared the AR-supported assembly with different computer instructions and a paper manual. In their study, they were able to show that AR support reduced the error rates of the task. When it comes to in situ projections, Funk et al. Presented various studies on the potential of projection-based AR. They showed that locating parts and assembly actions are completed faster compared to other instruction types. As many other studies, the mentioned works focus on task completion time, error rate, and perceived workload measured by the NASA TLX. In 2019, Wilschut et al. Presented a first work about learning with projection-based AR. They measured the immediate learning success after a training session with projection-based AR. However, they could not find any differences compared to working with electronic work instructions. According to our knowledge, there is no previous study about the long-term effects of projection-based AR training. Consequently, there is only weak empirical evidence regarding the training efficiency of the system and no evidence regarding the knowledge sustainability. As already mentioned, we want to consider two effects. First, we look into training efficiency, which we consider as the time taken for learning a procedural task. We assumed that a personal training is the optimal case in terms of efficiency and consequently better than paper-based training or AR training. But we assumed that AR training is still more efficient than a paper-based training. These relations are reflected by our hypothesis H1 to H3, which you can find in our paper. Second, we consider knowledge sustainability, by which we mean how well participants remember the task after 1 week. Here, we assumed that users could benefit from the spatial presentation of information in the personal training, but also in the AR training. Consequently, we assumed that personal training and AR training would lead to a better knowledge sustainability than a paper-based training. However, we did not assume any difference in the AR training and the personal training. The hypothesis H4 to H6 in the paper relate to the knowledge sustainability. So here's a short overview on our study design. We ran a study with a between subject design with groups for the three different training conditions: personal training, AR training, and paper-based training. we recruited 33 participants. However, 6 participants dropped out during the study, and 3 participants have been excluded from the data analysis through incomplete learning in the first session. From the remaining participants, 20 were male and 4 female. The age ranged from 14 to 51, with a mean of 25 years. The experiment was carried out in German, and 18 were German natives. The non-native speakers were balanced to the groups. Each of the participants took part in 4 sessions, a pre-test session, 2 training sessions, and an evaluation session. So let's go more into the details of the procedure. In the first session, we did some pre-tests and collected the demographic data. Based on the data of this session, we assigned the participants to one of the 3 groups. In the first training session, the participants were trained in the assembly task. We let the participants execute the assembly task repeatedly under the training condition. We stopped the learning phase when they were able to execute the task without help and without error. We measured the number of executions and the time. After 24 hours, we scheduled the second training session. At the beginning of the second training session, we let the participants execute the assembly case without any help. We observed the task and noted any errors. If participants made errors, which was usually the case, we continued with the second training session. As on the first training day, we let the participants execute the task under the training condition until they again could do it without help and errors. Again, we measured time and the number of executions. We invited the participants to an evaluation session 6 days after the second training. In this session, we evaluated the remaining knowledge about the assembly task by 2 means. First, we let the participants execute the task again without help and observed errors. Second, we integrated a knowledge quiz. Using these 2 methods, we were able to learn about the remaining knowledge after 1 week. So here's a short overview on our setup that was used for all 3 conditions. You can see an assembly workplace which is similar to those that you can find in industry. It basically consists of a table and some crab containers for the required parts. Above the table is a projector for the in-situ projections. Furthermore, we attached a camera to record all sessions with the consent of the participants. We attached a base plate to the table on which all parts of the task had to be mounted. While previous studies often used Lego Duplo bricks, we decided to use a different assembly task. We used this pneumatic construction set by the manufacturer Fischer Technik that you can see in the image, which has 24 parts in total. Since the base plate was fixed on the table, 23 steps had to be executed in a defined sequence. Compared to Lego tasks, this task has different kinds of assembly steps, which makes it a little bit more complex. Still, no tools are needed for this task. Here you can see an overview of our assistive system. The system mimics previous research and commercial systems. It shows projected instructions in the work area, such as videos, mounting points, picking information at the crab containers, or error indications. We implemented 4 different support levels with different amounts of support. The participants were free to change the support level during the experiment whenever they wanted. For the recognition of picking actions and correct or incorrect assembly steps, we used a Wizard of Oz approach. And here you can see the assistive system in action. This video was taken during the study. It shows a participant working with the system. This is the second level of support, so the participant did get information about mounting points and the location of parts. So now you can see that the participant made an error, so the system makes the user aware of the error. Now the error is fixed and the participant can continue the assembly process. The manuals for the other 2 conditions are straightforward. Of course, we try to present consistent information in all 3 groups as far as possible. In the image, you can see the paper manual. For the trainer, we defined a short guideline. The trainer was always the same person, and he followed a defined standardized procedure. As I mentioned earlier, we evaluated the knowledge of the participants after a week, not only by executing the task. We also included a quiz that each of the participants had to complete on a computer screen. The quiz contained 25 questions. There were two question types, as you can see in the photo. Now let's go to the results. First, we look into the results of the training efficiency. To the left, you can see the number of training cycles. To the right, you can see the total training time in minutes. One interesting finding is that we did not have any significant differences between the groups on the first training day. However, on the second training day, the participants of the personal training group needed much fewer training cycles compared to the other groups. The number of training cycles of this group is below 1, which means that a lot of participants that received the personal training did not need the second training because they executed the task without any errors after 24 hours. So what we conclude from this data is that the personal training group had a more comprehensive understanding of the task after the first training day. Again, I'd like to stress that the termination condition on the first training day was identical in all groups. Furthermore, there were no significant differences in the training sequences or times on the first day. Still, the personal training seems to have had the best effect on the first day, resulting in a shorter training on the second day. Comparing the AR group to the paper manual group, we did not see significant differences. However, I have to add that we excluded two participants from the paper group that systematically learned the task in an incorrect way. This was only possible in the paper group, since participants in that group did not receive any feedback. If we hadn't excluded these two datasets, the paper condition would have resulted in worse training efficiency. So we can clearly say that AR assistive systems prevent the systematically learning of incorrect work steps, which indirectly leads to better learning efficiency. When we look into the data of the knowledge sustainability, we can see a significant difference of errors between the personal training group and the other two groups after 24 hours. The average number of errors in the personal training group is below 1, meaning that a lot of participants did not produce any errors after 24 hours. However, when we look into the number of errors when executing the task after 1 week, there are no significant differences between the group. The same holds true for the quiz results. On average, the participants answered about 20 out of 25 questions correctly, regardless of the group. So what does that mean? Well, even though we had a small difference after 24 hours, we did not recognize any differences in the knowledge sustainability after 1 week, not in the quality of the replication of the task, not in the quiz, and even if we broke down the results based on error or question categories, we could not see any differences. You can find more details on that in the paper. So basically, once the task was learned, the knowledge persisted in the same way, independent from the learning condition. So last, we were questioning why there were differences after 24 hours, but not after 1 week. It might be the case that our study setup with the second learning phase balanced out the differences. Let's look back at our initial hypothesis. With regards to training efficiency, our study showed a slight advantage of the personal training over the other two conditions. However, we have to reject the hypothesis that AR-based training is faster than self-learning with a paper manual. Regarding the training sustainability, we could not measure any differences between the groups. Consequently, we have to reject the hypothesis that spatial representation of information leads to a better knowledge retention. So, I come to the conclusion of my talk. We ran an experiment that investigated projection-based AR assistive systems for training. As expected, we found that a personal training had the best training efficiency. AR-based training can be used as trainerless alternative. It successfully prevents systematic incorrect learning. However, other advantages could not be proven by our study. We found that once the assembly task is properly trained, the recall precision is independent from the training condition under which the task was learned. As future work, we plan to investigate how certain aspects from personal training can be integrated into assistive systems. We believe that if assistive systems become more intelligent, The qualities of a personal training might be reached. Thanks for listening to my talk. If you have any questions or comments, please get in touch with us. Thank you.